Of, and I think I have a title there for you. So last week, if you were here, I started talking about the kingdom, and that was the kind of the message. And the reason for that was just recently started on Thursday nights in the book of Mark, kind of exploring the Gospel of Mark, and I've gotten so much amazing new stuff from there already that I just couldn't contain it all on Thursday, so I'm overflowing onto the weekend. So last week was, I'd read in Mark chapter 1 about, you know, the gospel of the kingdom, and I just got all kinds of excited about it and, you know, started studying it out more and wanted to share that with you. And then this past week, as I was reading still in Mark chapter 1 and just studying in there, I got to the part again about where Jesus was baptized in the Holy Spirit in the River Jordan, and the Spirit of God came upon him in the form of a dove. And I really got just captivated by that. And there was some questions that I had that I'd never personally really had answered before, to my own satisfaction. And so I really began seeking God about this. Like, I wanna know more here. I got some questions. And so the Holy Spirit, how wonderful He is, began to show me some things that I hadn't seen before. And I'm very excited. I want to share them with you. So let's start in Mark chapter 1, verse 1 through 11. I'm going to read this first passage here because that's really what we're based on. And it begins with the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The gospel of Mark, by the way, is short and it's hard hitting. It's like very action packed and it's fast moving. And Mark is kind of a man of few words, and he just boom, 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 right to the point. Right? And so here's something that happens in 11 verses here, and a couple of the other gospels takes like three chapters, you know. And Mark just goes boom, boom, boom. Here you go. As it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you." Who was the prophet that announced Jesus? It's John the Baptist, right? And the voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." That was a prophecy from Isaiah about what John the Baptist's message would be, preparing the way of the Lord, right? Because remember, when a king would visit a city in those days, they would make sure that the road was prepared beforehand for the king to come in on a good road. And here, what John the Baptist was saying was, prepare your hearts, right, for Jesus to come in. And then it says, John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now, if you were here last week, and if you weren't, I'd really recommend you get the CD, honestly. And I don't usually like push my own CDs that much, but last week, if you missed it, I'd really recommend getting it, because what's fascinating is that all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right, when you open them and begin to read the first couple of chapters, what you find in all of them right away is two announcements that are very, very powerful. The one announcement is the kingdom of God is at hand, right? Or the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In fact, John the Baptist and Jesus both said, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And repent is a word, remember, in the Greek that simply means change your mind, right? That's all it means. Change your mind, wake up. There's a kingdom coming, there's a king coming. Wake up, respond to it, deal with it. Choose, right, loyalties, alliances, allegiances, right? Respond to this kingdom. And what's interesting about that, again, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all open with that statement, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And what's interesting is to compare it with what Jesus did not say. He did not say, hey, there's a new religion coming. I know you got a bunch of them out there, but here's a new one. He didn't say that at all. He said, there's a kingdom coming. Deal with it. Here it is, right? And it's invading, and he began to demonstrate it right away. Healing the sick, casting out devils, just came on the scene with power and confrontation, and people were getting healed, and devils were cast out, and people were getting free, and he's announcing the kingdom. And this isn't, hello, here's a new religion. This is, here's a kingdom. Boom, right? And so the Gospels open with that statement and kind of force us, if you read it that way, they force you to deal with that, right, that fact, which is a good thing. And then the other thing that they all open with, I'm coming to here in a minute, let's keep going here. All the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to Jesus, John the Baptist, and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. So they're you know, preparing their hearts, and they're looking at obvious things in their life that need correction, and you know, they're accepting this message. Now John the Baptist is baptizing people. What does baptism mean? You guys remember? It was a Greek word that meant to immerse. So if you dunk your donut in your coffee, you baptized your donut. That's all it means, right? So it's not a really highly, you know, spiritual religious word. It just So they were dunking people in the water. What did that mean? That was actually a practice at the time. In the Jewish community, some of the rabbis and teachers, they would have followers, right? And they would have people that would be their disciples and learn from them. And so they would baptize them as their followers. That was a way of saying, I'm being associated or identified with this rabbi or this teacher, right? I'm his student or whatever. And so that was a common thing. So when people are getting baptized by John the Baptist right here, what's happening? They're actually saying, I'm accepting John the Baptist's message. I'm recognizing him as a prophet of God, and I'm believing in his message that the Messiah is coming, and I'm preparing myself. And that's what they were doing, right? And go ahead. And then John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. Radical, radical character there. We talked about this Thursday night for a while for some that were there. But why does it mention that John the Baptist is wearing camel's hair garment and a leather belt? Because if you read back in the Old Testament, that's how the prophet Elijah dressed. Okay? He was known for that. And so John the Baptist is being associated here with the prophet Elijah. Wasn't there actually prophecies in the Old Testament? Before the coming of the Lord, I will send Elijah the prophet, right? And he will prepare the way. So before Jesus came, John the Baptist came fulfilling that prophecy. And he wasn't literally Elijah. He came in the spirit of Elijah. And Jesus acknowledged him later on and said, all you guys remember John the Baptist? If you can receive it, he was Elijah. Right? And so he brought that spirit. Now, before the Lord comes back again the second time, the prophet Elijah will come again. And at this time, I think literally. But that's a whole other story. So anyway. So he's preparing people, and he preached, saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. Hey, this is all about preparing for Jesus. And verse 8 says, I indeed baptized you with water, right? Immersed. But he will what? Baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Yeah, yeah. Now, what's really, really cool about this, again, I mentioned a minute ago that all four Gospels open with two announcements. The first one is there's a kingdom coming. And there's a king. Deal with it, right? And the second announcement that all four Gospels open with is this one from John the Baptist. I'm baptizing you with water, but Jesus is going to come, and he's going to baptize you with Holy Spirit. And again, what he doesn't say is more helpful, maybe. What he doesn't say is, again, hey, there's a new religion coming. Who wants to sign up, right? He doesn't say that. He doesn't say when Jesus... Now, check this out. He doesn't say when Jesus comes, he will show you the way to heaven. He doesn't say that. Now, it's true, right? Well, Jesus is the way to heaven. He is the open door, right? He is it. And it's true that he does. But that's not what the message is. Everybody wants to go to heaven. Jesus is going to show you how to go. He didn't say that at all. He said, when he comes, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Which means the purpose, the whole thing that God's been leading up to for over 1,000 years there, over 1,500 years of scripture and prophecy and prophets, is getting a people that will be ready to be filled with the Spirit of God, empowered by the Spirit of God, living and partnering with the Holy Spirit in a supernatural way. That's what it's all leading up to. It's the purpose. Wow. You mean it's not just go to church once a week and go to heaven someday? No. That's never what it was about. It's always been about, here's a kingdom, here's a king, and he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. So what I want you to also, if you jump back to verse 8 for just a second, please, what I want you to also wrap your head around real quick is we just read Mark chapter 1 verse 1 through 8, and what I wanted you to see is all that information that he just gave you very, very quick, boom, John the Baptist and here you go, and Holy Spirit. That was all given for one reason, to bring you to verse 8, to bring you to this verse. Boom, boom, boom. Here's why he's coming. Ready, set, go. Right? And then, just in case you might ask yourself the question, wow, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. What does that mean, God? And he says, oh, I'm so glad you asked. Here it is, verse 9 and 10. Mark gives you some additional information. It came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Jesus comes now, please, yes, stay there for a second, please. Jesus comes, and he's getting baptized by John in the water also. And that's an interesting one, because The message was repentance from sin, right, and confession of sin and getting ready for the Messiah, none of which Jesus needed. He didn't have any sin to repent of, right? He is the Messiah, right? And he's getting baptized by John the Baptist. Why, right? And there's a couple of reasons why. One was, again, the idea that when you're baptized by, you know, one of these teachers in Israel, or rabbis, whatever, you were acknowledging their message, right? You're accepting their message. And Jesus was publicly honoring and validating the message of John the Baptist. He is a prophet of God. I'm acknowledging that publicly, honoring him. And he says, go ahead and baptize me. Even John was like, I don't think so. And Jesus said, go ahead and do it. And then the other thing here is that this baptism was a baptism of repentance. And this is just an interesting thought for you. Remember that everything that Jesus did was for us, right? When Jesus became a man, did he need to do that for himself, or did he do it for us? He did it for us. And Jesus died on the cross. Remember, he died. Did he just die for us, or did he also die as us? Right? Yeah, it's a huge revelation that you have to have as part of your understanding here. Everything Jesus did, he didn't just do it for you, he did it as you. He died on the cross as you, so when you accept Christ, God says, oh, you already died. And you're like, I did? Really? Yeah, back there at the cross you died. Right? And then Jesus rose from the dead, and God said, now you've risen from the dead also. Like, I did? When? Jesus did it as you, right? And the moment you get born again, you are spiritually raised from the dead, literally. And then Jesus ascended into heaven, and he sat down at the right hand of the Father. And Ephesians chapter 2 says, you are now seated at the right hand of the Father in Christ. Everything Jesus did, he did as you. The moment you accept Christ, it's all yours. It's all credited to you. Amen? So you're seated right at the right hand of the Father right now. Are you trying to get to heaven, or are you already in heaven? The correct answer is you are actually already in heaven. If you're a believer in Jesus, you're already in heaven. You're not trying to get to heaven. You're there. Right? And what our really challenge is to do, and our call is to bring heaven to earth, right? I'm not trying to get to heaven. I'm trying to bring heaven to earth, all right? And so you're already there. You're already seated. It's already done for you. Everything Jesus did, he did as you and in your place, and he did it perfectly. And so when Jesus is baptized in the river, a baptism of repentance, what he actually did, it was a perfect act of repentance by one who didn't need it for himself, and it's credited to you. Because when we repent, guess what? We don't do it perfectly, do we? I've never repented perfectly in my life. How about you? Right? And so, but Jesus did a perfect repentance. It's credited to you. Died, credited to you. Rose, credited to you. Seated at the right hand of the Father, credited to you. Go ahead. And then immediately as he was coming up from the water, it says he saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. Quite literally, I believe that the sky opened up visibly, supernatural way, and there was a view into heaven somehow, and people saw this. There's people around that are getting baptized and listening to John, and there's a crowd there, and they see this, and out of the opened heavens comes the Holy Spirit upon Jesus in the form of a dove. Okay, and then verse 11 says, then a voice came from heaven which said, you are my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. So, now keep in mind, everything Jesus did, he did it for you and as you. So, is that yours now too? That's yours now too. The Father says to you now, if you're in Christ, you are now my beloved son, daughter, and I think you're amazing and I love you. That's yours. That's yours. Jesus didn't need that for himself. He did it for you so that you could have that. And then, So it opens with this amazing statement of relationship and identity, right? It wasn't just, you are my servant, go do my work. It was, you're my son, I love you. Ah, right? Go rock the place. Right? And so it opens with that identity and that relationship. But it also opens with, if you jump back to verse 10 for a second, with this anointing of the Holy Spirit and power that comes upon Jesus in the visible form of a dove. And God, the Holy Spirit chose this form of a dove for some reason to come upon Jesus, because he doesn't always look like a dove. On the day of Pentecost, he came like tongues of fire and rushing mighty wind. Right? Holy Spirit, right? He's taking these symbolic forms that we to tell us something, to speak something to us. Now, this is the baptism of the Holy Spirit that Jesus experienced. And again, you know, beautiful question, if you don't know, why did Jesus need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? He's God, right? Well, I mean, think about what was the result of this experience? Jesus is right here, 30 years old. And up to this point, he has done no miracles, no healings, no teaching, no preaching, Nothing like that. He's been a carpenter, making tables and chairs, whatever, right? Nothing supernatural, no power, no ministry. He's 30 years old. Now he goes to the river. He's baptized immediately. The Spirit of God comes upon him. He begins to preach. He begins to teach. He begins to heal the sick. He begins to cast out demons and say, here's the kingdom. Yeah. So it was the baptism of this of the Holy Spirit coming upon him that empowered him to do that. But Jesus is God. Why did he need the Holy Spirit? He could do all this stuff himself. Yeah, but he came to live as a man, right? He became a man. He laid down his power as God, his knowledge as God, everything. He laid that down. He became a man, a simple man like us, dependent, completely dependent on the Father, because he had to undo what Adam did. And he had to be a man like us to undo it. He couldn't cheat and use his own power as God. He had to live as a man, dependent, right? And obedient on the Father. And so at this moment, he's anointed by the Holy Spirit. Then he begins his ministry of power. Miracles and healings and amazing things happening. Okay, so very cool. Why did he do that again? He did it so he's the forerunner. He's the model. He's saying, this is what you're going to have. Because remember verse 8, when he comes, Jesus comes, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. He says, this is what it's going to look like. Here's the model. He receives it. He begins to walk in it. And he says, pretty later on, you're going to have this. All right. So this is interesting. So we know the point of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's pretty clear from Scripture that it's to receive power. And later on, Jesus, after the resurrection, he said to his disciples, right, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and then you will be my witnesses in the world. Right? So the point is power, and Jesus himself received power here and began to operate in power. But my question, the thing that always has kind of just tugged at me a little bit is, okay, if the whole point of the ministry, if the whole point of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is to receive power, then why did the Holy Spirit come in the form of a dove? Because if you were trying to come up with a symbol for power to speak to people about power, how many would choose a dove? Nobody. Nobody. Not a soul. We're like, no, that'd be like the last symbol I would choose. Because doves are soft and gentle and actually kind of shy. You know, right? And you're like, that's not a symbol of power. And a dove. And suddenly, boom, he's moving in power. And I always question them. I'm like, I don't get it. I never have understood that, God. Could you help me out with this one a little bit, you know? And there's several things that, you know, about the dove that maybe we do understand that do speak to us. The dove was it's a bird, right, that flies through the air, so it's a heavenly creature. So the Holy Spirit coming like a dove speaks of heavenly being. Okay, good enough. The dove was probably white, you know, and we not all doves are white, but some are, many are. And the dove was probably white, which speaks of purity, speaks of holiness, right? And doves are gentle. They are gentle creatures. And isn't it true that the Holy Spirit is ordinarily gentle in his nature? It's true. It is true. There's other interesting things about doves. I looked up some stuff just that I didn't know. And you know that doves mate for life? One of the birds that mate for life. So when the Holy Spirit comes to you to live in you, he says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. That's pretty cool. But why a dove? Not a symbol of power. I was talking about with the youth group a little bit on Friday night about this very thing. And I said, what would you have chosen for a symbol of power, you know, instead of a dove? Beth was here earlier. Beth said, if you're looking for a symbol of power, right, you would choose like a monster truck. Right, like heavens opened, heavens parted, and monster truck came down from heaven, and Jesus began to move in power. You know, like, yeah, that's good. I would go with that, you know. But it was a dove, right? Dove. I'm thinking, why dove? Well, in the Bible, there are some explanations given. One we've talked about before, if you've been here a while. In the Bible, there's something called the law of first mention, which means that any time in the Bible something is introduced for the first time, it's definitive, right? It's defining something, and it's speaking for the future. You need to know the first time anything is introduced in the Bible. So the first time, if you look for the dove in the Bible, the first time you find it is in Genesis chapter 8. Let's go there. Genesis chapter 8, it's 6 through 12 here. And this is after the flood, right? The flood of Noah. And God saves Noah and his family. They believe, they build the ark, they enter in, they're saved, everything else is destroyed, and now the waters recede, and Noah, the boat, rests on land. And it says, it came to pass at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark, which he had made. Okay? And then he sent out a raven, which kept going to and fro until the waters had dried up from the earth. I thought, raven, what's a raven have to do with anything? Raven is a symbol of darkness, and it feeds on death, which means that after the flood, the curse was still in the earth. Okay? The flood didn't get rid of the curse. Keep going. And then he also sent out from himself a dove. Now, here's the first mention of the dove, and it's going to be prophetic and symbolic. Some of you know this one. We talked about it not too long ago when we did a series on the flood of Noah. So Noah sends out a dove, which represents who? Holy Spirit, of course. Right? And to see if the waters had receded from the face of the ground. Okay? The dove flies out from the ark, but the dove found no resting place for the sole of her foot. And she returned into the ark to him, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. So he put out his hand and took her and drew her into the ark to himself. So the dove goes out the first time, looks for what? A resting place, right? And the resting place in the original language there implies a permanent resting place. Not just a place to land for a few minutes, but a permanent home, permanent resting place. And the dove found no permanent resting place. Remember what Noah's name even means? It's rest. Okay? So the dove finds no permanent resting place, comes back to the ark. He pulls her back into the ark to himself. Verse 10 says, and Noah waited another 7 days, and again he sent the dove out from the ark. Okay? And then the dove came to him in the evening, and behold, a freshly plucked olive leaf was in her mouth. And Noah knew that the waters had receded from the earth. And then he waited another 7 days and sent out the dove, which did not return again to him anymore. Okay, I read that dozens of times before I started to understand. This was a prophetic picture of Old Covenant to New Covenant, right? When the dove goes out representing the Holy Spirit, the first time, it's the Holy Spirit who goes out into the world under the Old Covenant, right, before Jesus, and finds no permanent resting place. Why? Because mankind has fallen in sin and can't be a permanent home for the Holy Spirit. Right? However, the next time the dove goes out is with the ministry of Jesus. Right? And when the dove comes back with the olive leaf, it means the finished work of Christ. The finished work of the cross, the blood was shed, the price was paid, the resurrection was accomplished, reconciliation between God and man is accomplished through Jesus Christ. Right? And the dove brings back the olive leaf, symbolizing the work of Jesus. And then Noah sends the dove out again, and this time the dove finds a permanent resting place. In who? In us. People who receive what Jesus did, the Holy Spirit comes to live in us permanently in the new covenant. Wow. And he says, I will never leave you, never forsake you, right? Okay, so this is beautiful. This is a prophetic picture of new old covenant, new covenant, and the work of Jesus. Very, very cool. But it still doesn't explain why Jesus is baptized, why with the dove, right? Why the dove comes down. It still doesn't explain that exactly. And then if you jump to Leviticus chapter 5, verse 7, let's do that one. Now here's the next real significant mention. There's a couple of other smaller mentions of doves, but here's the next really significant one. And this is what really began to speak to me here. In Leviticus 5, God is telling Moses about, right, the sacrifices to bring under the law. Right? So when the people would sin, and they were guilty of sin, what did they have to do under Moses' covenant? Right? They have to bring an animal and sacrifice it at the altar at the temple, and the animal dies in my place and pays for my sin. It's all symbolic because an animal really can't pay for my sin, right? But it was all symbolic, and every time they sinned, they were sacrificing an animal. Right? It's called a trespass offering or a sin offering. And really, that sacrifice speaks of Christ, of course. And then there also, they would bring something called a burnt offering. And a burnt offering was you take the animal, sacrifice it the same way, lay it on the altar, essentially, and the whole animal's body is burnt up by fire on the altar of God, which symbolizes something. It symbolizes a life that is totally given and surrendered to God. A life that is totally laid on God's altar, right, and surrender, say, your will be done, right? And so the fire of God comes and consumes it because the Bible says our God is a consuming fire, right? And that's a burnt offering. It's a life surrendered to God, lived for God. And God, but these are symbolic, and God's telling Moses how the people are to do the sacrifices, and they're supposed to bring, you know, the animals from their herds, and the cows and goats and sheep and whatever. But he says, but here he says in Leviticus 5:7, if he's not able to bring a lamb, then he shall bring to the Lord for his trespass which he has committed two turtle doves or two young pigeons, one as a sin offering and the other as a burnt offering. So the dove here is mentioned as an animal of sacrifice. Introduced as an animal of sacrifice, particularly for the poor person who can't afford a more expensive offering, okay? And so he brings two turtle doves or two young pigeons. I didn't know until yesterday, when I looked this up, that doves and pigeons are really the same bird. I didn't know that. They are. Yeah. Pigeons are doves. There's a family, you know, there's a family of doves, and there's like hundreds of subclasses of doves, right? Smaller, larger, whatever. And a pigeon is a kind of a dove. I didn't know. So anyway, so you bring two doves or pigeons, and they're an animal of sacrifice. One is a sin offering, one is a burnt offering. Sin offering, again, is covering your sin. The burnt offering is a life surrendered to God. So this is very interesting. There's another reference, Leviticus 14:22. Which said essentially the same thing. Bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons, such as he is able to afford. Again, the implication being this is the kind of the poor man's offering, right? And one shall be a sin offering and the other a burnt offering. So this is where God really got my attention on this one. So if Jesus was baptized in the water and then the Holy Spirit comes upon him in the form of a dove, began to put it together, the dove is really a symbol of sacrifice and of sacrificial living. Oh. Oh. Now it's getting interesting. It's not just a symbol of power. It's a symbol of a life that is laid down to God, surrendered to God, and lived sacrificially for God, lived sacrificially for others, and ultimately the cross, the life completely given and sacrificed at the end. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon Jesus in the form of a dove, he is anointing Jesus as a man to live a sacrificial life, a surrendered and laid down life, all the way to the end, in a supernatural way that is really against human nature. Now, fallen people, right? People that are infected by sin, do they like to live sacrificially for others? No. What sin is, by definition, sin is basically a selfish nature. Sin causes selfishness, self-centeredness, self-exaltation, self-will, self. That's what sin is. It just amplifies that whole thing. It's me, what I want, and I'm going to get what I want. And that's sin. And so human nature, especially fallen human nature, is like all the opposite of that, right? But Jesus came, he's sinless, but yet he struggled with this. We know that because right before Jesus went to the cross, what was he doing in the Garden of Gethsemane? Sweating blood, saying, Father, if there's any other way. Right? Because even the human nature, even sinless nature, says, whoa, right? Living in sacrifice. And so the Holy Spirit comes upon him at 30 years of age in the form of a dove and saying, I'm anointing you to live a sacrificial life, to go all the way with this. And when you live a sacrificial life, also what comes is power. But power doesn't usually come without a sacrificial life. Oh. You guys with me so far? Okay, yeah. So this is really, really interesting. And now what God began to show me from that moment then also is that living a sacrificial life is the expression of love. And God is love, right? And if God is love, what that was going to produce at some point, because by God's nature, he is love, love always expresses itself sacrificially. Love always expresses itself somehow in sacrifice. And I'll explain that fully so you know what I'm talking about. Love has to express itself in sacrifice. Ultimately, God was going to make himself a sacrifice to save us.
Hallelujah.
He had to do it. It's his nature. You can't go against your nature. Ultimately, you will do what's in your nature to do. And God is love, and He would eventually make Himself a sacrifice to save us. And no, love is never expressed without sacrifice. Let's explain this. Ephesians 5, verse 1 and 2. Start there. So this is written by the Apostle Paul, and he says, therefore, to us, therefore be imitators of God as dear children. What does that mean? How do you learn to speak English or eat with a fork or dress yourself? By watching mom and dad, right? Okay, and that's what he's saying. How are you going to learn to live now as a Christian? Watch daddy. Be imitators of God, right? And he'll teach you how to live. He's your father and you're his dear children. Go ahead, verse 2. And then he says, he gets more specific. What does this mean? Be imitators of God as dear children and walk in what? Walk in love. And now here he's going to give you the definition of love. He's going to give you the very definition of love. As Christ also has loved us and what? Given himself for us. An offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Oh, this is getting really, really good. I don't know about you, but I'm liking it. So, it's getting really, this is interesting. He defines love as sacrificial living, doesn't he? That's what that verse says. Love is sacrificial living. Love is never expressed without sacrificial living. You can't express love and totally maintain your own comfort and your own convenience. It's impossible. When you express love, it's going to involve sacrifice. Now, in Jesus, it involved the ultimate sacrifice, his life on the cross for us. But he tells us, as Christians, walk in love as Christ did. What's he saying? You don't have to die on the cross. You have to live a life that is lived in sacrifice, expressing love. What am I sacrificing? My time, my pride, my ego, my will, my plans, my future, my ideas. All of it is a sacrifice. I lay it all down on the altar of God, give my life to God, and say, God, I want to live sacrificially, loving you and loving people. Wow. Do you have to do that to go to heaven? No. All you have to do to go to heaven is accept Jesus as your Savior, and someday you go to heaven. Let's just do that. That sounds easier. No, actually, what I want to do is be a disciple. This is disciple. I want to be a disciple. I don't want to just be a Christian and go to church once a week and go to heaven someday. I want to be a disciple. But being a disciple involves what? Sacrifice and love. And it's going to a deeper place. So he's telling us, walk in love as Christ also loved us and gave himself for us. And it tells you an offering and a sacrifice, which again tells you that all the Old Testament offerings and Old Testament sacrifices, they were all speaking about Jesus. Jesus fulfilled them all. But then it also says, for a sweet-smelling aroma. What's that? A sweet-smelling aroma. When there's sacrifice, God goes, oh, that's good. That's interesting. What's that about? Actually, you have to, again, let's go back in the Old Testament and pick out, well, no, let me give you one more verse before I do that. Philippians 4:18. Just so you see one other. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the Philippian church, and what you have to know about this one is that the Philippian church was actually sending offerings, financial offerings, to the Apostle Paul on a regular basis for his trips, his missionary work, and they would raise offerings and send it with somebody. And Paul acknowledges that, and he says, indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you. And then how does he describe that offering? A sweet-smelling aroma. An acceptable what? Sacrifice. Well-pleasing to God. Huh. So sacrifice, when you give an offering to support ministry work, is that a sacrifice? Absolutely. Absolutely. And God says it smells really good. Ah. What does a sacrifice mean? What does a sacrifice actually mean? On the Old Testament, we get it. Every time there was a sacrifice, guess what? An animal died. Take a sheep, take a goat, take a dove, a bull. You kill the animal. That's a sacrifice. When sacrifice means something dies, right? So when you give an offering to support ministry, You give your tithes or your offerings. Is that a sacrifice? Yes. What dies? The money that you gave dies to you. Because what? It's not yours no more. You can't spend it anymore. It's like it died to you. You laid it on the altar and killed it. It was a sacrifice. And why was it? And what was the purpose of that sacrifice? It's love, right? It's for a higher purpose, isn't it? Yeah, for the gospel to be preached and for ministry to be done and the body of Christ to be built up and the kingdom to grow. And also God builds into the financial offerings. God builds in all these amazing promises in the Bible, right? When you give, he says, I will bless you. I will increase you. Doesn't he? Absolutely. So there's sacrifice, but the sacrifice is always an act of faith and an act of trust. Because if I'm giving you my tithe or my offering, right, I'm trusting you, God, that you're going to supply me. Right? I'm not buying anything with my offering, am I? I'm sacrificing something. It's dying to me, and I'm trusting God that you're going to bless me more. Amen? That's what that is. It's faith. It's total faith. And so sacrifice always involves the death of something. If you wanted to spend time watching TV, you know, for the whole evening, and somebody calls and says, oh man, I really need somebody to talk to. I really need somebody to pray with me. And you go, okay, let's get together and let's talk and let's pray. You just made a sacrifice. You took your TV time and you laid it on the altar and you killed it. And you went to give some time to somebody else. It was a sacrifice, wasn't it? It's an act of love. It's an act of love. And love is always expressed by sacrifice. And there's no true expression of love without sacrifice. It's going to get better. So let's jump back to Old Testament too. I want you to see a couple of verses that have to do with the sweet-smelling aroma. I want you to see that. Genesis 8, 20 and 21. This is back to the flood and the ark. And after the flood was over and the ark is on land, it says, Noah built an altar to the Lord. And he took of every clean animal and of every clean bird, and he offered burnt offerings on the altar. Burnt offering, again, represents, right, the laid down life, the surrendered life. And then what? Verse 21. And the Lord smelled, oh, what does it say? A soothing aroma. The Lord smelled a soothing aroma. Really? It smells like barbecue to me. But all you need is barbecue sauce. But God smelled something else. God smelled the sacrifice. It's symbolic. It's an animal sacrifice, but God smells the sacrifice, which speaks of Christ, doesn't it? Speaks of Jesus and his act of love and his act of salvation and sacrifice for us. And God smells the soothing aroma, and God said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground for man's sake, even though they're still a mess. They're still messed up, but I will never again stomp them all out. I will, like that, I will, right? And there's something about, well, let's move on. Also another one is Leviticus 1. We'll read verse 1, 2, and 9. Which is, again, this is when God is telling Moses about the sacrifices that the people of Israel are to do, to make. And he says, the Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tabernacle of meeting, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when any of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the livestock, of the herd and of the flock. Okay? Sheep, goat, cow, whatever. And then jump up to verse 9. And he says, you kill it at the altar, you sacrifice it, and then he says, you wash its entrails and its legs with water, and the priest shall do what? Burn all of it on the altar as a burnt sacrifice. An offering made by fire, and see that last line? A sweet aroma to the Lord. Whew. Sweet aroma to the Lord. So every time there was that sacrifice, it wasn't barbecue, it was God smelling sacrifice. And God says, that is soothing and sweet to me. Why? Remember what we, part of it speaks of Christ, of course. Jesus, you know, prophetically being shown that Jesus is going to die for us on the cross. It smells like Jesus, of course. But even more specifically, remember what Ephesians 5, 1 and 2 said? If you jump back there. Yeah. Be imitators of God as dear children and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. What Jesus did on the cross was an act of love. Love has to express itself in sacrifice. And the reason it smells so sweet, the sacrifice smells so sweet to God, is it's an act of love. And that smells sweet to God. Selfishness stinks in heaven. God goes, ugh. When we're acting all selfish and me, 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 and it's all about me and what I want and what I have to have and blah, 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 blah. And God says, ooh, yuck. And when we live sacrificially, laying down our life, our time, giving of ourselves in love, God says, oh, that's good. That's good. Well, look at another verse. It's in Ephesians, also chapter 5, but jump down to verse 22. So now this one says, wives submit. Now it's going to talk about marriage, right? It says, wives submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Right? And all the men go, yeah, 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 right? Keep going. And verse 23, for the husband is head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church. And the men go, yeah, that's right. Right? And he is the savior of the body. Uh-oh, now it's going to cost me something. 24. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands and everything. Okay, we're on good ground again. Yay, all right, okay. Now it's really going to cost me something. 25. It says, husbands, love your wives. Ah, there we go. Okay. Love your wives. And what is our definition of love? Sacrifice. Love your wives just as Christ also loved the church. And what did he do? Gave himself for her. Oh yeah, you don't get to be the head without sacrifice. You don't get to be the head without great sacrificial love. I know the men were like, I just want to get married and sit on the couch and watch TV and have the remote control and she could bring me food. That would be great. That's not how it's going to work. Because God says, no, to be the head, you have to live a life of sacrificial love. And a whole lot of it focused on her. Yeah. Otherwise, you're the head of nothing. You know. And now this is, so this is getting, this is where it's getting, you know, a little more clear here. Because love is always expressed in sacrificial living. If it's not expressed in sacrificial living, it's not really love. You can't maintain your own comfort and convenience and express love. It doesn't work. You guys, you remember when you were a bachelor and then you got married? Was there a sacrifice involved? I'm sorry, ladies, I'm not insulting you, but if you go from bachelor life to married, is there a sacrifice involved? Yeah. Yeah, what'd you just lose? Well, your freedom, one thing, right? Laid it on the altar and killed it. Gone. Now I'm thinking about another person, and every decision I make and every way I spend my time and every word I speak and everything I do influences or affects this other person, and all, right? And now I have to give of my heart and give of my time, and there's sacrificial living involved, right? Is it worth it? Is there a purpose? Of course, absolutely, yes. What does it say there? 26 and 27 says, why did Jesus do it? So that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, and that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing. She should be holy and without blemish. What did Jesus get out of that sacrifice? A glorious bride. A bride who's, that's us, right? Collectively, who becoming day by day, becoming the glorious bride for Jesus because of his sacrifice. Not because he stomps around and demands that we do everything he say, but because he gave himself sacrificially for us. Why did Jesus do it that way? Because, I mean, think about this again. Jesus lived a life of sacrifice to the Father, to us, 2,000 years ago, right? His whole life and ministry was laid down ministering to people, his time with the Father. Did everybody Jesus loved and sacrificed for, did they all appreciate it? Not at all. Some people loved Jesus, some people spit on him, some people crucified him. So when you live and love sacrificially, will everybody appreciate it and respond wonderfully? Not necessarily, no promise. Not at all. Some will. Some will. And Jesus is getting out of this deal. Some people spit on him, some people crucified him, some people would do it again today, but he also got people that said, I'm yours, I love you. You've won my heart, you conquered me, I'm yours. And so when you, and what he's saying to here to husbands, when you love your wife sacrificially, what you're actually going to get out of this thing is a rich, rich oneness, union, and relationship that's beautiful and full and rich and amazing, right? If you give sacrificially, if you love sacrificially. But if you don't do that, you won't have that. And then, how many know once children show up on the scene, there's a little bit more sacrifice involved? Right? Now what are you sacrificing? Sleep, everything probably you just gained from the marriage. I mean, there's all kinds of sacrifice involved, right? You just were introduced to sacrifice a little while ago. Now children show up, now there's real sacrifice, right? Now there's huge sacrifice. And the sacrifice continues, doesn't it? It does. But why does God call us to that? That's love, that's how we learn love. That's one of the ways we learn love. And love is always costs sacrifice, doesn't it? It always does. And our culture today in America, I know, and in many places, our culture is very sick. Our culture is very selfish, very self-centered, very me, my comfort, my convenient, I deserve my rights, everything's for me and everything's about me. And our culture is sick. But if you follow Jesus, you know what you'll actually become is a person who loves and lives sacrificially. Completely against the current of our culture, but that's what you'll be. And do I have to do that all by myself? No, because the same Holy Spirit that came upon Jesus like a dove comes upon you and anoints you to live sacrificially, transforms your heart so that you become like him. Remember the glorious bride? Jesus gave himself for us so he could get this glorious bride. Is Jesus going to be all sacrificial and loving and his bride is all selfish? Not at all. But by his love to us, his sacrificial love to us, we get transformed and we learn to live sacrificial love also, and we become the glorious bride that Jesus' heart wants to join to. You become like him in his image. Wow. And so part of God's training for us is marriage, children, things that part of us goes, oh man, more sacrifice? Yeah. And Holy Spirit says, I'm with you. In fact, I'm going to anoint you. I'm going to cause you to love this, and I'm going to cause you to understand what this produces. With me so far? All right. Let's see. Ephesians 6:4, I'll just read it, but I've already made the point. It says, you fathers and mothers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. He's speaking of sacrifice when children are on the scene, but a much higher purpose for that. If you love your children, live sacrificially for your children. Again, we live in a very broken world. Is there a promise that they all turn out perfect? No, it's a broken world, right? But if you live sacrificially and love sacrificially, you know what? What you will likely have is some children that really serve God and that really continue the kingdom and carry Jesus into the world, and amazing things are produced by this. There's no fruit without sacrifice. There isn't. There's no real fruit without sacrifice. And we're what we're seeing in the scripture is that love and sacrifice are the same thing. They are. They are. I'll just give you two more quick scriptures, and then we'll pray. 1 John 3. Verse 16 to 18. I just want you to see that this same concept of love and sacrifice being the same thing, that this is in other places also in Scripture. 1 John 3:16 says, by this we know love, because Jesus laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for who? The brethren. Now he's talking about church, the Christian community, right? And so he said, wow, I'm sacrificing in marriage, I'm sacrificing in children, now you want me to sacrifice here too? Yeah. I thought church is a place I just go and I get encouraged and then I go home and it's over. No, church is a place where you learn to live sacrificially and care about other people and give of yourself. Hopefully, if it's a healthy church, right? That's where you actually learn to give of yourself more. More? More. Yeah. Verse 17 and 18 also says, but whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? And 18, we'll read also. It says, little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. What's John saying there? That if you see someone in need, keep in mind there's exceptions to that rule. You know what enabling means? I just have to lay this out too before, because he doesn't deal with this in this verse, and we have to. If somebody is consistently making bad decisions and you keep helping them, sometimes you're doing what's called enabling them and allowing them to continue to make bad decisions with no consequences. That's not a good thing. Okay? But then there's other times when people are in a tough situation, probably through no fault of their own. They're in a tough situation and they're hurting and they need help. And he says, real love gives. Real love helps, steps up and helps. Okay? So what is he talking about? Sacrifice. Because if you give something to someone that's in need, guess what? It's not yours anymore. It died to you. You laid it on the altar and killed it. You gave it away. But God says that's love. So again, there's enabling, that's a different thing. You don't want to do that. There's love, sacrificial love. You do want to do that. And you have to know when and who and how and that's a whole other matter. So I just wanted to throw that out there. But I want you to see that, again, love is sacrifice. It just is. And then finally, Matthew 16. I'll close with this one. It's 21 to 25. And this is during the ministry of Jesus, close to the time he's going to the cross. It's almost time for the cross. And he's with his disciples. And it says, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised the third day. So he's literally starting to tell his disciples, right? I'm going to go, they're going to torture me, arrest me, accuse me, they're going to kill me, but I'll rise from the dead. Okay? And his disciples are going, what? We don't understand what you're saying. Doesn't compute, we're not processing it, we don't know what you're talking about. Right? They just couldn't wrap their head around that at all. Right? He had to tell them several times and they still didn't believe him. They didn't get it. So then, verse 22, and then Peter, after Jesus says this, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. And so all Peter heard, he didn't hear raised from the dead, all Peter heard was die. Right? And he says, no, can't happen to you. And this is, actually, why does Peter say this? His motive is not bad. Peter's motive is he loves Jesus. It's like, I don't want you to die. I don't want you to suffer. No. We'll rally around you. We'll protect you. We'll fight for you. This won't happen. What are you talking about, right? So his motive is not necessarily that bad. But look at what happens. Verse 23, Jesus says something, boom. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. That's rough, right? I hope Jesus never calls me Satan. That would have to hurt a little bit, right? but was it really Peter? Was he calling Peter Satan? Or was he talking to the source where Peter got that thought? That's really what's happening here. He's talking to the source where Peter got that thought. And Peter's thought, now even Peter in his own self is kind of motivated by caring for Jesus. It's not an evil thought necessarily, but he it is... Peter is responding to the idea of sacrifice by saying no. And the thought is coming from who? Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You're an offense to me. You're not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. Go 24. Oh, no, stop there. Stop there. So back in 23 for a second. I'm sorry. There we go. So what just happened here? You have to see it. When the idea of sacrifice is on the table, Satan says no. Jesus says yes. That's what you got to see here. Jesus says yes to sacrifice because it's love. Satan says no. Don't do it. Wow. And then 24 and 25. Which we've read recently, a few weeks back, in another message. And Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. We read that out of that context. This was the context where sacrifice was on the table. Satan says no. Peter picks that up and says no. And Jesus is saying yes. And he says, in fact, Peter, you have to understand this. If you want to be my disciple, it involves sacrifice. If anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And again, remember, they didn't know Jesus was going to the cross. All they knew about a cross is that's how Romans execute horrible criminals. Very shameful, humiliating, painful way to kill criminals. And Jesus is saying, take up your cross and follow me. What's he saying? You want to be my disciple, you die. There's a sacrifice, you die. Who dies in the sacrifice? You do. I do, yes. What does that mean? Die to pride, die to ego, die to selfishness, die to self-will, die to it all. Lay your life on the altar and say, God, I'm yours. Right? Wherever this takes me, the answer is yes. Whatever you want me to become, the answer is yes. Whatever you want me to do, the answer is yes. Wherever you want me to go, the answer is yes. However you want to change and transform my heart and my soul, the answer is yes. I'm yours. I'm laid on your altar. No conditions, I'm yours. That's what Jesus is saying here. Do I have to do that to go to heaven? No. I can make you a list of many, many churches you can go to. I'm not trying to insult them. Please don't take it that way. I can make you a list of churches you can go to. Be a Christian. Go to heaven when it's over. Okay? But I can also, there's a shorter list of churches where you can go and become a disciple. We're one of them. We're not the only one. There's others. There's lots of them. But it's a shorter list. It's a shorter list. Trust me. And I'm not in this just to have a nice church and go to heaven someday. I'm in this, I want disciples. I want to be a disciple. I want to be a disciple and make disciples. You can't make what you aren't yourself, right? You can't reproduce what you're not yourself. So I'm in this, I take this seriously. Jesus, my answer is yes. Here's my life on your altar. Yes. Yes, yes. Right? Amen. Whatever you want to do. And I think that's probably why most of you are here too. Because that's what you get here. So now it's not what you like. I mean, I can find you, right, make you a map somewhere else, you know. But that's what you get here. And ultimately, verse 25, I think Jesus finished it with that thought. Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. But I can guarantee you that the greatest, fullest life is found after you go through that laying down your life, dying to pride, self, ego, dying to all of that, and you come out the other side living for Jesus with that issue all settled, and now it's all about Jesus. I'm in love with Jesus. I'm crazy about Jesus. It's all about Jesus for me. And you come out the other side on that thing, that is the greatest life you'll ever know. It is awesome. It is fun. It is power-filled. It is supernatural. It is amazing. It is glorious. It's also hard sometimes, isn't it? But it's the real deal. It's the real deal. So I guess where we started off with, why did the Holy Spirit come upon Jesus in the form of a dove? Was it just about power? No. It begins with sacrificial living and sacrificial love. That's really where the kingdom is. That's really where discipleship is. I love miracles. I love healings. We have them here. I love them. But the real fruit, the real miracle, the greatest miracle of all is a changed heart. That has changed from being selfish to being loving and giving and sacrificial and laid down. It's the greatest miracle ever. Ready to pray? All right, let's stand together, please. And again, if you're not physically comfortable standing, that's fine. Not a problem. Just if you're new with us in any way, what we do is take a few minutes and invite the Holy Spirit to come and make the Word become faith to you. Make the Word become revelation, become life. Let it transform you, speak to you, challenge you. So, Holy Spirit, come in Jesus' name. Just lift our hands and lift our faces to heaven. Open hearts, open souls. Jesus, touch us now. Jesus, we say yes to you. Yes to you, Jesus. Yes to your love. Yes to your salvation. Yes to you dying for us on the cross, rising from the dead. Yes to eternal life. Yes to forgiveness of sins, but also yes to discipleship. Yes to laying down our lives. Yes to giving ourselves to you. and being transformed and learning to live sacrificially, learning to live in supernatural love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It'd be helpful just to pray that. Let's pray it together. I'd rather have it in your own words, but I think it's easier if we pray it together. Just say with me, yes, Jesus, I give you my life. Yes to discipleship. Yes to sacrificial living. Taking up my cross. Following you. I give you my life. I lay it on your altar, God. Transform me. Make me what you want me to be. To everything you say, my answer is yes. Yes, yes, yes. And Holy Spirit, come. Baptize me. Fill me. Anoint me. Come as the dove, the spirit of sacrifice, spirit of love, to transform me and anoint me to live that life with you. In Jesus' name. Ooh, that's good. Just stay in his presence now. Let him breathe on you. Let him come and touch you and fill you. Holy Spirit, right now, yeah, as we've prayed, you're coming. You're washing over people and filling people, baptizing people with your presence, your love and your power, anointing us to live a life of love and sacrifice, to follow Jesus' example in a supernatural way, a way we could never do without you. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Dove from heaven. Fill your people. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The greatest transformation is when you live sacrificial love, not for what you'll get out of it, but because it's just who you are. It's just who you've been transformed into being by Jesus himself. It's just who you are. It's just what you do. Jesus, transform us so that this isn't a religious act. This isn't something we do to get something. Jesus, transform us so that we become like you. And sacrificial love is just who we are. It's just who we are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shalavarena kode shalavarena. Wow, Jesus. We bless you. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Shalavarondavirite sublarakashavare. Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Good. Everybody blessed? All right. God bless you. I love you guys. Thanks for coming.